sent by God to prepare the way.
Living right there, verses 3, 4, 5.
Telling everyone to repent today.
It's recording.
John Floyd cried from the wilderness, the urgent warning for all to hear. The world had become such a mess. The day of the Lord was drawing near. John came to prepare the way and ready our hearts for that day. John, will they listen? Will they hear? Will they believe and tremble in fear? John, what do you say? Is the warning still the same today?
The Zoom is up.
When he comes, will we shout and cheer, or will our hearts tremble in fear? John, you came to prepare the way.
Thank you.
Who was a pastor?
Talking this month about preparing because it's Advent, and the Advent season is the beginning of the new church year. For us today is January 1st. And it's a new church year, and we spend the next few weeks focusing on the coming of our Savior, the coming of God into our world. And so we're going to talk about that, and as I said, we're going to focus mainly on John the Baptist over the next few weeks. And our text is the gospel lesson is read, the story of God. Let's begin in prayer. Lord, open our hearts to you. Lord, open us that we may see your presence.
He starts walking around.
You know you are. We may scan in you. Help us, Lord, to take hold of you. And, Lord, to understand what we're preparing for. Amen. Anybody got Christmas decorations up yet? No, me neither. A bunch of people have, though. Already. Day after Thanksgiving, you get to start putting up the Christmas stuff.
Put your hand on this. And
it's a time of preparation. That's exactly what it is for us. It's a time of preparation for the Messiah. To be focused on Him. This is God's time of preparation. The time that He prepares His people for His coming. And He did that by sending John the Baptist. He sent John in the wilderness with a message to prepare the people so that they would be ready when Christ came. And here we are 2,000 plus years later, and the message is for us the same too. The same message of preparation is for us today also. And John came with that message, and that message was to repent. God sent John so that people would know that God was coming. God sent John so that people would hear about the Messiah, that would hear the answer. You and I, God still does the same today. He sends people into your life and in my life to bring us a message to Christ. None of us are here by ourselves. We're all here because somebody, somewhere in our lives, told us about Jesus. Somewhere, somebody in our lives shared with us God's love. Somewhere in our lives said that we could repent and be free and be forgiven. And that's exactly what God is doing, sending John into those people's lives, and call us to be sent into other people's lives to share that message. And again, that message is repent. To humble yourself before God. Now, let's get us honest. How many of us associate Christmas with repentance? We usually associate Good Friday with repentance, or Lent with repentance. You know, getting prepared for the death of Christ and suffering, etc., etc. But God sent John in with the message to prepare people's hearts for the birth of the Messiah by saying, repent. Now humble yourself before God. Literally live. To repent of your selfishness and your self-centeredness and worrying about me all the time and what I want instead of what God is calling us to do. To repent of our comfortable walk with God, where we get to the point where we're just so used to going to church and we're going so used to talking about God here and there that it really doesn't mean anything anymore. And to repent of our judgmental attitude and our I'm better than that belief that we hold on to so clear as we look down our nose at other people. Repent. That doesn't seem like a Christmas theme. You think joy. You think angels. You think hallelujah. You don't think repent. And yet, repentance is the right attitude for Christmas. It really is. To understand that in Christmas it's a time to prepare by repentance is vital, because it's in repentance that reminds us why Jesus was born. We get all caught up in the baby. And the baby's, you know, the little baby in the manger, and the little sheepy standing there looking at him, and the shepherds there, and the wise men, and it's that beautiful little scene that we always see, and then the kids do, and then we have our little manger stuff, and we go, ooh, and all over the baby, because that's what we do over babies. But do we realize that that baby is there? Because in 30 years from now, they're going to cut him, they're going to flog him, they're going to beat him, they're going to throw a crown of thorns on his head. They're going to take that nice little beautiful baby and put him on a cross and kill him. Because of Eden. Because of me. Because of our sin. When we stop and take time to realize why we need to repent, we understand why it's important for Christmas, because it's our sin that brought Christ there. If we hadn't sinned, Christ would not be there. If we hadn't sinned, you and I wouldn't be lost and needing God so desperately and needing God's grace so powerfully. Repentance separates the season from the Savior. It's so easy to get caught up in all the hoopla about Christmas. It's so easy to get so wound up about it. How many times do we, at the end of Christmas season, say, thank God? Or do we say, thank God it's over? How many times are we just glad when we start to say, okay, now I got to put the stuff away and I'm done with it? Why? Because we get so caught up in the season. And repentance brings us back to the point that you and I need a Savior. You and I need this God who came on earth for me and for you. You and I need to take hold of that. We remember why this is all happening. Because God wants you to be with Him. And God is going to pay the price for our sins. Repentance turns our hearts towards God. Not towards trees and tinsel, or presents and packages. Towards God. Towards this season that, because it's a holy season, not because snowmen sing, or because jingle bells ring, or any of that other stuff, but because God came to us. Repentance turns our hearts to God, because God, this season, came. He became a man, and came into my world, and came into my sin, and came into my death, and came into my life, and came into my garbage. Because He loved me, and He didn't want to be separated. And finally, repentance is the right attitude, because it's the way we greet God. Repentance is the attitude you and I should have when we come before God. Think of Moses standing in front of the burning bush. Or Isaiah, when he was lifted up to heaven and he saw God, and he says, "Who am I? I'm a dead man." Or how about Peter? When they're out on the boat and all of a sudden he catches the fish and he realizes who Jesus is. And what's the first thing he does? He drops to his knees and he says, "Leave me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." When we come in front of the holiness and the righteousness and the utter purity of God, the response is to repent. The response is to realize just how sinful we are, how dirty we are without Christ. So we come with repentance.
Next screen.
What does that mean to have repentant attitude? It means that we're to humble ourselves before God. Truly humble ourselves. When's the last time you actually got on your knees to pray? When's the last time that you even got down below that on your belly or on and bowed down before God and prayed? Most of us, our prayers are done after we brush our teeth and wash our face and we get ourselves all fluffed up and we pop into our pillow and we fluff it up and cover ourselves up nice and warm and then we turn our thoughts to God. I'm comfortable, so now I'll talk to you. The last time we humbled ourselves, we said, "God, you're God. You're Creator. You're in charge. You're sovereign. God, I'm nothing. I'm," as the Old Testament lesson says, "I'm nothing but grass. It's here today and gone tomorrow. But you're here for everlasting to everlasting. You created me, you formed me. You loved me in my mother's womb. You're God. Humble ourselves before you." And then secondly, to confess our sin. Not just that I've sinned, to understand that truly I am a sinner, that my very nature, down deep in my very soul, I'm black. I'm guilty. It always amazes me when people say, "I just can't believe someone could do that." It does not amaze me at all, no matter how gross it is, what someone can do. Because that blackness that you see in them is in you too. That absolute disgusting sin that you see in them is in you too. The only difference between you and them is that's how it came out in them, not you. We're sinners. We don't have any right to hold our hand. We don't have any right to say, "Look at me," to the world. Rather, we said, "Look at God." That's the thing about confession. There's no ands, ifs, or buts to it. We gotta get rid of that. We gotta stop excusing it. "Well, I know I shouldn't feel this way, but. I know I shouldn't have said that, but. I know I shouldn't have done that, but." No. You did it because you wanted to do it. Whatever the sin was. Because that's what's inside of you. And we confess to God, "God, I am by nature sinful and unclean, and I have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed." No excuses, no game. "Here I am." And then we seek help. We seek help by putting God first in our lives. We seek His help and His power in our lives. We seek to become aware of Him every day, every moment. To put Him in our thought process every day, every hour. Whether I'm at work, whether I'm at home, whether I'm at school, whether I'm with friends, whether I'm out, whether I'm whatever. That God is in my thought process and I'm aware of His presence every passing hour. Aware that He's there with me. Aware that this Savior who came and died for me did it for what's going on in my life right here, right now. And then rely. Rely on Him. Rely on Him to deal with the problems. Rely on Him to handle the situation in our lives. And say, "Lord, Your word and Your will be done." And make obedience a priority instead of something. something we hit and miss with. To make obedience, today I'm going to seek to my best to be obedient to God and do it. Not just what I think about it when I feel like it, but do it. That's what it means to be repentant. And that's what we need to be because God is coming. We need to begin to understand who's coming, who this Christ is that we're seeing. It's not just a little baby in a manger. It's just not a little cute scene that we have. It's not a prophet. It's not a good man. This in that manger, this God who comes is the one who spoke and might have. This God who comes is the one who says there is no darkness in him at all. He is pure. He is holy. He is righteous. This God is bigger than you can imagine and bigger than I can imagine and more holy than we even dare think about. One whose sin can't even come near him. That's who came. That's who came. That's who left his throne in heaven and was being found in a child born of a virgin. God has come. Emmanuel, the eternal God, has come. And the wonderful thing is come to save. In all his righteousness, and all his holiness, and all his power, God has come and is coming to save us. To save us not from him. Save us from ourselves. Save us from the hell that we put ourselves through. The hell that we allow Satan to run us through. The hell that we live in on a regular basis because of our sin and our guilt and our actions. He came to save us from that. He came to save you and give you your life. To say, come, be clean again. For your sins are scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Eat and rejoice in the richest affair, for I love you and I care for you, and I have taken that pain and that sin and that guilt and that unbelievable blackness upon myself, and I've paid for it with my blood. Christmas season is a time to repent. A time to rejoice. We repent because we take God so often, Christmas so often, so lightly, so cavalierly. We repent because we, instead of accepting and acknowledging our sin, we excuse it. Instead of living with our hearts and thanks to God, we complain and grumble. So we repent. And then we rejoice. Because when God Almighty comes, he didn't come to condemn you. He didn't come to damn you. He didn't come to make you pay. He came to take the payment. He came to bring you life. He came. That's how we repent. Amen. Now may the peace of God who passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus from this day forward to life everlasting. Amen.